Bay, and we're here at Edna Bloom Dolls with various people to talk about Frank R. Adams and the Newfer Adams Playhouse. So that's me, and then next is Grace.
I'm Grace Atkinson from Whitehall, Michigan.
I'm Peg Vandeventer from Sylvan Beach, Michigan.
I'm Edna Bloom Doll from Whitehall.
And I'm Shirley Milne from Sylvan Beach.
I'm Harriet Pearson Berman from Sylvan Beach.
I'm Jean Yeager Michelson from Montague.
Okay, let's just see. This is Peggy Vandeventer talking.
That the theater was built in the first place. Frank moved to Sylvan Beach and bought the house, which I now own, in 1908. And he stepped right into taking care of the Wabanenko Jinx, which was put on once a summer. There had been two preceding shows that Harriet, I think, must have been in. But from then on, he took over with Jim Newfer and the Sidoni family's help. And I think they both became so enthused in having a theater, which Whitehall at that time didn't have, that probably was what started their interest in starting a theater here in town. Mm. Sounds logical.
When he came in 1908, did he buy that house or did he build
your
house?
Yes, he and Will Huff, his good friend, had spent two summers at the Irish Village, which is on the south side of White Lake, and they loved the place. And during that time, Frank saw Sylvan Beach and thought it was a great place to be, although the house he wanted was occupied by the man who built it. And
which house was that?
Sutherland was his name.
Okay.
In the meantime, Frank married Hazel Judd, who's called Trix. And I don't notice the date of their wedding, but it had to be before 1908, because that's when they both bought the house. And from then on, Percy, both of them worked with the Jinx.
So the house was built and they purchased
the house
it
was built in 1906.
Okay. Because what I was picking up was I thought that house that you are in, the house built in 1906, has similar construction, like it's stucco, and to me there's a certain similarity to the architecture of the Playhouse
Theater.
Yes,
that's right. I think that influenced it quite a bit.
Yeah.
Because I think Jim Newfer and he got together and decided that they'd have something similar. I've heard that it has wonderful acoustics. Is that right?
The theater,
the Playhouse, exceptionally fine acoustics.
Gracious.
I know a little bit about that, but maybe someone else knows more
Grace,
than
Grace
I
Grace was saying something about that.
Well, I was just saying that when we raised the money to restore the Playhouse and Howmet came in with us, they called in, I can't remember his name, Carlos somebody, he was the speech director or the theater director at Community College. And he said he was giving suggestions, and he said the first thing will have to go is that back wall. Well, that black back wall was the only, it's what makes the theater acoustically perfect. And it was called something in German, but I can't remember the name, Horizon, and it's curved. And I said, well, you better not take out the back wall, because when that wall was put in, it was the only one in the United States in any theater. And Frank Adams knew about the one in Germany that was very famous. And that is how that came to be. And I hope it's still there.
It is. It's still there.
Hmm. Okay. Edna, you want to say something? I suppose we can talk about the theater. Or we can talk about Frank Adams too.
What Grace
you know?
Has said at this point is so important about the construction of that theater and the fact that it does have acoustics that are almost perfect, and it's the thing that has not been recognized along the way. You're not recording what I'm saying. I'm just talking.
Actually,
this is the thing that is important for more reasons than one. The only reason that I'm here is because I worked with three different shows with Frank. I'm one of these people who are so grateful for having worked with me.
But like when you say that the theater was built, Jimmy Newfer, who's Jimmy Newfer? I mean, it's a Newfer mill, but like, why is Jimmy Newfer in Whitehall, Michigan, involved in with Frank Adams in building the theater?
Evidently, just a combination.
They were very close friends.
Work together. After all, Jim had the Bowl Mill down here.
Okay.
I think it was sort of a natural combination.
So the Newfers
would. The fact that it became a combination.
The Newfers would have had some capital, and Frank Adams would have had.
That's right. Because possibly at the time that Frank was here, he was already working in theater in Chicago.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
And at the time that I remember when I worked with Frank, which would have been previous to 1925, because I came here in 21. And in some way or another, got to be at the piano for the three Masonic minstrel shows that were given, and then also was at the piano for the Black Parade, which is some of the stuff that's here.
That was in 26.
And that would have been in 25. That would have been in 25. So between 21 and 25, I worked with three minstrel shows that were Masonic minstrels and listed as the 310 Club sponsored.
And that had to do with the Eastern Star, right?
Because one of those shows we did in Ludington, we went on the road. During that period.
That's this program that you had here. It must be Ludington because it has Carl Ashbacker's store that he had, and that was the one that founded WKBZ in Muskegon, and it was in Ludington.
Roger, Frank went to the University of Chicago when he was 22.
Okay.
And he started something that's still going in the university. It's called Blackfriars. It's something like Princeton does, where men are the entire cast, mm-hmm. and that's still popular. And he and Will Huff, whom we met at that time, put on shows.
Wait, there's another name in there. What's the third name?
Howard.
Oh, just for the song, Joe Howard.
Huff mm-hmm. Adams and Howard.
Okay, because those three worked together,
and they did.
They had three successful shows going in Chicago at the same time.
Before
Huff,
they were 22.
Adams and Howard?
Mm-hmm. Joe Howard. He was a vaudeville man.
He was song and dance man.
Song and dance man.
Okay.
Yes, and I think the first of those shows, musical comedies, was A Stubborn Cinderella. And that was the first time that John Barrymore was ever on a stage. He was in that show. That's where he made his
debut.
Is that
right?
Yes,
Stubborn
Cinderella.
Is that like a musical or is it a comedy? Mm-hmm.
They were musical comedies.
I think that's all Frank did was musical comedies.
Yes, musical comedies.
Okay.
It's most successful.
Was Time, the Place, and the Girl, back in 19, was it? Time, the Place, and the Girl was another one. I can't remember the third. I had the music to all
of them. Was another one, I think they did.
And that would be back in around 1900 it started.
Yes, mm-hmm. yes it would.
When did you say he went to University of Chicago? 19.
Pardon?
He went to the University.
He went to the University of Chicago. Yes, in 1922.
22.
Wait a minute. When he was 22.
Oh, okay. right. Okay.
He never finished college. He dropped out before he graduated because he was so involved in putting on shows in Broadway.
Okay.
But later, the university gave him his degree. Oh, years later, he was given his degree after he became famous.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The years at the Playhouse, then, if they built it in 1916, it ran through, obviously this program is 1926 when you did that in Ludington, Edna, but like you mentioned 1925, it ran for like maybe 10 years? When did it start?
There had to be that period in there of where there was just movies.
Mm-hmm. Wasn't it the Sidonis that first had the first movies?
Well, wait. There was a community group though, that the theater was...
White Lake Dramatic Club.
The White Lake Dramatic
yeah,
Club.
Yeah, my father and mother were charter members of that.
Mm-hmm. Edith Pitkin was in that group, and Clarence, and...
Yeah. There were groups...
And possibly the Radcliffes.
Well, the Opera House or something had burned down, you see.
Yeah.
And this group got together, the White Lake Dramatic Club. Mm-hmm. And there were, there were the G's, they had a funeral, funeral right. home and hardware store, some combination.
Yeah. And a beauty parlor across the street.
Yeah. And they were all in it, and they wanted a theater, and that's how it started. And...
How did they get the money for the theater? Was it popular subscription?
Well, Newfer put in most of it, but they did pay, to join the White Lake Dramatic Club.
Oh, I see.
But I don't know how much.
I was wondering who furnished the money for it.
And mm-hmm. then the same people put the plays on? Or?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay.
But then they drew from others. Others, you didn't have...
The cost wouldn't... After all, we're going back into the 1920s. The cost would not have been... So great.
No.
Because I'm just thinking, after all, what this house, for instance, was sold to somebody or another for $4,500, and that sort of gives you an idea of what
mm-hmm. what prices
what,
were yeah.
what the costs might have been.
Were different
at the,
dollars.
That's too. Right. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. What else? Where do you think we're going to go with this? We discussed something. So the theater continued on until 26, and then did it go on until the Depression?
And during the war years, when Frank was overseas, they continued to
this
do
is 1914-18 war.
Well, he or which when war? Did we got in at 1917.
He got in at 17, was out
and
by
he,
20.
He was overseas, and then his wife, first Mrs. Adams, directed the shows, did the dances. She had been on the stage herself
yes,
in Chicago.
That.
And I never met her, but she was a very pretty woman. I'm wondering, her name was Hazel. They called her Trixie, but the Sidonies always called her Haiti.
Her name was Hazel Judd.
Uh-huh. Yeah, and they called her Haiti, the Sidonies
yes,
did.
Yes, mm-hmm. that's right.
But then her nickname, too, was Trixie, I guess.
Yes, she was full of it, too,
uh-huh.
Trixie.
Yeah, oh, yes. Yeah.
Because this one program was listed as... Okay, the 310 Club of Whitehall presents the Black Parade, an Afro-Expeditionary Farce, July 15th, 1926. And it says, note, the Black Parade is the story of one night from dusk till dawn in France during the year 1918. Significantly, it tells what happened to Company E of the 369th Regiment Infantry USA. And, of course, I picked up, what are all the showgirls doing on one night in France? With the 369th Battalion.
The another interesting thing.
Right, they're Black Parade.
All the costumes are made locally, and you will see how many of those costumes are done with oilcloth. Good. My sister happens to have was in that, and
we didn't have. Polyester or any other things?
No.
It had to be oil
cloth.
Actually, let's go through something because I think maybe this will pick up on Frank Gowd's personality or whatever.
Yeah.
Okay, this is the Black Parade and Act One, and this is the regional stuff that I was thinking about because Michigan does the same thing. Michigan or the 1916 one. Okay, Act One, Scene One, a street in Whitehall tonight. Scene 2, a street in a French village 8 years ago. Scene 3, a road between Paris and Berlin at midnight. Paren, during scene 3, the audience is requested to imagine that it is facing toward the American lines. That means that if you were the enemy, you would be shooting at the actors on the stage. But don't do it. Just imagine it. Okay, Act 2, program continued. Scene 4. An enemy machine gun nest at the end of the road 10 minutes later. During scene 4, the point of view of the audience is exactly opposite of what you were in scene 3. You are now looking toward the enemy trenches and are headed in the same way as the American troops. Scene 5. a street in a French village the next morning. And that somehow is, okay, no, let's see, we should go on, okay. Scene one, the music, over there, Private Frank Lundwall. I mean, that's over there, over mm-hmm. that one, okay. Scene two, this is my lucky day. Mm-hmm. Can't hum that, okay. Three, soup, male chorus. The village blacksmith, Private Everett King. Okay, oh, how I've waited for you, Helen Kern and YMCA. Is that some relatives of you? Mm-hmm. Helen
it's
Kern?
Their sister.
Okay. Mm-hmm. It don't do nothing but rain, Private Albers, always. I think that's I'll Be Loving You Always, that one. Private Charles Swenson. Give me a little kiss, will ya, huh?
You give me a little kiss, will ya, huh? Just a little kiss, dum-dum-dum-dum-dum-dum.
Boy, I can remember sitting there at the piano and trying to phrase these things out for these guys that never had sung a note in their life.
Anyway, that song was also done by Helen Kern and the YMCA Entertainers, okay. Number nine is Charleston. And that is Brightwell Kids. Anna, Glenetta, Noreen, Carrie, Glenetta Howard, Freddie Brown. Okay, A Long Trail.
Oh, yeah.
A Long Trail.
Long, long trail.
Until the day.
Okay. First Lieutenant Arnold Dahlstrom. Just a Sailor's Sweetheart. It's your favorite. Helen Kern is back again. Okay. How are we going to win the war? Captain Harry Skeels. Okay. Medley of War Songs, male chorus. Hinky Dinky Parley Voo. Okay. Yeah. Mademoiselle Farmitz. Okay. Flame and Mamie. Private Alvin Alberts.
I wonder if some of those weren't written by Frank.
I kind of wonder too.
Could be.
Some of them.
I wouldn't doubt that.
I think some of them aren't.
But I think the amazing thing about that show was the fact the treadmill on stage, mm-hmm. which was built by Joseph Sidoni and with the help of Art and Joe, the brothers, these sons, and that treadmill, these men are on stage and they are marching.
Okay.
And moving because of that treadmill that is on stage. So they are moving. You're in the audience and they are moving toward you.
Okay.
But never get any close to you. I think maybe that's the way I have to explain it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Actually, you know, there's more. There's like a scene five. That certain party, Miss Lucille Lauterberg.
Yeah.
That certain party. You got a tune to that one?
Yeah.
Okay. Bye Bye Blackbird. Horses. Sergeant G and the YMCA Entertainers. Finale, the entire company.
Wasn't that horses, 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 crazy over horses, horses, horses all of the time.
Okay.
That must be it.
Then in the orchestra it mentions crazy different people, but Edna Kern Blumdahl is mentioned there. And production directed by Frank Adams. Dances, Mrs. F.R. Adams and Miss Lorna Margrave. Properties, Alvin Wickstrom. Chief Electrician, Willis Pierce. Stage Manager, Joe Sidoni. Mechanical Effect, Harry Young. Stage Carpenter, John Jensen. Okay. Why don't we talk more about, like, you know, let's just say Frank Adams, the man, the person kind of thing. And if you knew him in those early days or something like that, Peggy, maybe you could say something.
Now, say that again to me.
Okay. Frank Adams, the man, and if, like, you knew him, and yes. So just maybe something about personality and interests and things like that.
Well, let's see. He was born in 1883. His father was an author and the editor of a newspaper in the small town. And I don't know where he went to high school, but as I say, I do know where he went to college. He was there for less than 4 years. And during that time, as I said before, he was very friendly with Will Huff. Mm-hmm. And they were lifelong friends, for that matter, all of their lives.
Will Huff was a composer, a writer, a songwriter?
The two men were evidently stage-struck. They were just kids.
They wrote
the
books.
Pardon?
They wrote the books for the musicals.
Yes, they did.
Okay.
And I think they just fiddled around with this. And I think Frank must have done it in high school as well, because all of his life he liked to put on shows.
Mm-hmm.
And I think his whole life was putting on a show. He had names for everything that they did. He named the cars that they owned. He named the place where they lived. He named the pool that was beside them, and there's the swamp was called the Smiling Pool. Everything had a name, because he did an interesting thing when Lorna and their little daughter Penny went west. Frank put them on the train, and then with the two chow dogs that they owned, he drove the Rio, which he had, across the country on rough roads with many stops for blown out tires. Drove the two dogs to California, where they lived at that time.
What year is that? Like, is that in the 20s, 30s?
That would be...
It'd be the 30s, wouldn't it?
In the 30s, yes.
Okay.
Yes, this was after his first wife had died, and he'd married Alarna.
Okay.
They were very good friends of William Randolph Hearst, and often invited to his great big ranch out on the desert. And also, he was good friends with Cyrus McCormick of the Tribune, wrote things for the Tribune. And I brought some books here. In the old days, the magazines had short stories in rather than just ads. And I have several books he wrote for Muncie, for Cosmopolitan, for the Red Book, the Green Book, Liberty, Saturday Evening Post. He's got stories in all of those magazines. And I have several of these, which I would be glad to give to the museum if they want to, and also novels. This is one.
Like, what's the paperback that you have? That's called what? Rumsey?
This one?
Yeah.
Muncie Magazine.
Muncie, okay.
And he has a story in here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, called he wrote a number of books. I have no idea.
He wrote a lot of books.
King's
this one is
Crew was one.
He wrote after he got back from the service.
Mm-hmm. Oh, King's Crew,
very rather. Prolific man.
You happen
he
to have
everything. Smart Set, Cosmopolitan, all of those books. And
you got anything left on your book?
Liberty,
your book
and Liberty. No, these are all left in the cottage after we bought it.
They're wonderful.
And it's been fun. I've kept them, and the ads and everything are wonderful in them. Let's see, what things are these? 27.
Isn't she pretty?
Yeah. Actually, I just know for the tape, like, there's two Liberty magazines, a Cosmopolitan, a Smart Set, another Cosmopolitan, and the Muncie, which dated 1916. And they were all publications of, maybe we should, like the Liberty ones, okay, let's say that. They were April 2, 1927, April 30th, 1927. Would that be a saga, huh? And this was Cosmopolitan, October...
This one is July 1921.
They look kind of summer, don't they?
Right here.
The ads are so delightful.
Yeah.
In
oh,
August.
Yes.
They're
wonderful.
Okay, and then this is a Smart Set, the new Smart Set, 1930. Okay. And then the book is When I Come Back, Frank R. Adams, 1944, published by Robert McBride and Company. When I Come Back, 1944, okay.
It's, of course, a war story.
This book is dedicated to Margrave and the caissons go rolling along.
That was his wife.
Yeah, Lauren's name. Huh?
This one is rather risque. It's called Miles Brewster and the Super Sex.
Super Sex, okay.
Yes,
okay. All right.
But if the museum...
At least there was something in the magazines you could read.
Well, that's right. It was full of wonderful short stories.
He wrote a serial, too.
Yes, serial. That was fun.
The King's Crew was one. And the reason I remember that, because one of the characters was George Dixon, which was my father's name. It was nothing like my father, but he took, you know, he took names of people that he knew often. And then, of course, he did a lot of screen scenarios, too.
Yes, yes.
There's one that's on quite often. Joan Bennett has the lead in it, and I've been racking my brains to think of the name. It's on late at night often.
That Frank Adams did?
Mm-hmm.
A film?
Yeah, or he wrote a great many of them out there.
That well, Hollywood was quite new, too, when they went to
and,
live there.
And then in the 30s and the 40s, he was still writing
yes,
for them.
But he knew all the old-time Mary
Marie Dressler.
Yes. Oh, yes, Marie yes. Dressler.
Ralph Weed and Charlie Chaplin, all the big names, the old names of people. Mm-hmm. He knew them well. They knew them well.
Mm-hmm.
A secretary he had, Dorothy Blank, finally had the voice of the witch in Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know that.
Aunt Lily said that was a good part for her.
Oh, was it? I didn't know that at all.
Yeah.
Because Penny, when she had in the album, there were a lot of pictures of like Santa Monica postcards and things like that, of just kind of like shots of in an album that she had.
One thing that should be mentioned is the fact that Frank lived here long enough that he wanted to get involved in business.
Oh,
so he went in with Lloyd and Harry Carlson.
They had
the garage.
He bought
the old Carpenter garage.
Yeah.
So there would be Frank out there pouring the gasoline into the tanks.
Was he singing? Singing or writing lyrics as he was?
Perfectly all right, I don't know.
Yes,
no,
yes.
Lloyd Carlson was his secretary who lived with him down at the
beach, yes.
In that big house in the wintertime where they nearly froze to death.
I bet they did. I'm nearly
you
frozen now.
You bet they did. They hadn't, yeah, because I remember Leonard and I going down there and visiting him because not only was Frank a friend of ours, but also Lloyd was Leonard's friend from out in Fruitland Township.
Hmm.
Then he also had Paul Schnellenberger as a...
yeah, that's right.
As a secretary. And Lorna was the best of all.
Mm-hmm.
And she ended up being his proofreader as well.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That's right. She did a wonderful job.
Hmm. Okay. Let's see, what else? Harry, you have any thoughts? I can't believe that Harriet Pearson Berman has not said one word yet.
Well, we haven't given her
she hasn't had a chance.
The summers were so short, and we were here just for 2 months, and renting cottages, and the fact that we only came every other year, there was nothing to keep the Chittenden family involved with the Jinx every year.
You were in
Why
the Jinx, though.
Yes.
I have a picture of you and the chorus that was in it. It was Lorna Margrave was in it. I can't remember what year it was.
There's quite a group.
Mm-hmm.
Well, in this...
is that the one with you in it, Peg? Jinx?
Pardon? The one that's... Lorna starts the chain, and you finish it, but Carmi's there, Helen Bell is there, Barbara Wasson. Now, Barbara Wasson didn't live on the beach, but she lived on the South Shore. And Adele Wiesman.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
Betty Bennett was another one.
Virginia Flitcraft was there. Well, I called all but one, and I still haven't thought of that gal's name. That's in that published in the Spring Tides.
Oh yes, yes.
That group there.
Let's see, the girl I think you have was
somewhere in that black parade. One of those people in that chorus was Lorna, by the way.
Oh.
Yes.
Yes.
You might point that out, Grace, too.
Lorna was in that chorus.
If Lorna
was
in there.
Is she in
right,
this?
Right at the end. She's a little...
I can't see.
It would be over here.
Yeah.
Yeah, that, right at the end. Yeah.
That she's right there.
All of a sudden, I remembered she was in that course.
And then she's from Whitehall. She's in Margrave, and that's part of the Margrave.
Lived right down here on Lake Street.
Yeah.
They're a big family.
Yeah.
Sure. Margot Boardwell was a her cousin is Penny Margrave. Well, her mother was a Margrave, married Swan Alfredson, and Margot married Eddie Boardwell.
So Miss Chuck Margrave.
And Marguerite.
Audrey.
Yeah.
Betty. Mm-hmm. Laura.
Because my generation, there was like Judy Margrave.
One of the Nichols had Daniels. Yes. She worked in the book department.
Oh, yeah.
And in fact, I remember when I was in high school and had the lead in Merton in the movies, and Fran Cleveland was the director, and she said, "Grace, I want you to go into the Daniels and observe Betty Margrave, because," she said, "she is perfect for the part that you're going to play." So I used to go in and talk to her. Oh, yeah. And Audrey worked at the Occidental.
Yeah.
The candy shop.
Oh, okay.
The Colonial Inn.
The Colonial. That's Colonial where Inn. Yeah. That was.
So the people who acted in these productions were basically kind of like local people? Did they? Would it be like Cherry County Playhouse, where they'd bring in some named person? Or
no. Mm-mm. No. They were all local. From Muskegon and Whitehall and for the shows at the Playhouse.
But they imported the costumes right straight from New York.
Yes.
And they were perfectly gorgeous things.
Yeah.
I remember when they unpacked them, everybody got out an iron. And they weren't electric irons.
No.
They were sad irons that sat on the coal oil stoves or on the range. And they all had to be pressed.
Because one of the things I found fascinating in the Michigan program was like, there'll be a scene and it's going to be in the Nystrom garage, and then the next scene is in the telephone exchange at Whitehall, and then the next scene is on different scene, but it's like on the icebergs at Lake Michigan, and then there's the iceberg ballet, I'm picking up on all the regional stuff again, and that somehow I think weaving all this sort of stuff from here into his plots, which then you somehow want to figure out how did he do this and what's the plot or what's the script, and that's of course what I don't know.
There's a book in Hackley Library, or there was. It called, I think it was Famous Songs and Their Stories. And among the famous songs, and they have many, go back through the years, is I Wonder Who's Kissing Her Now.
Oh, that's right.
Uh-huh.
That's
and it tells, it said he was sitting on the front porch of his home at Sylvan Beach, and the conversation got around to some subject, and somebody said, "I wonder who's kissing her now." And that clicked with Frank, and he wrote the song, "I Wonder Who's Kissing Her Now." And that is used in the movie, that story of "I Wonder Who's Kissing Her Now," the life story of Joe Howard. Mm-hmm. And that song was in it.
And then Joe Howard was the vaudeville man.
Mm-hmm.
That was,
mm-hmm.
Okay, that's Hoff, Adams, and Howard.
Mm-hmm. He was older.
Did
he was older than they were.
When you say, "I Wonder Who's Kissing Her Now," did he write the music and the lyrics, or just the music?
The lyrics.
Interesting.
I think Howard wrote all the music.
He did.
They wrote the lyrics and the book, the stories.
Okay.
But the scenery was phenomenal.
Oh, yeah.
They were most creative. I can remember one of the shows that the Sidoni boys took over, and it was about in Rome, and the volcano erupted and all the lava came down. They had soap suds and people beating up the soap so that the foam would come down and the lava came clear across from way up in the back, down the front and off to one side. It was just spectacular how they managed to do this. But the Sebelny boys and their dad, Joseph.
And Charlie Abel.
Oh, and Charlie.
Charlie Abel.
Charlie Abel had been a strong man in a circus.
Yes, that's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And Charlie Abel was one of the people of the Sedoni camp, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Right. There's one more in that Sedoni, the guy that was the secretary.
Meredith.
Meredith.
Meredith Byers. Okay. Who was the explorer that went to the pole? Jack Bursey. He married Mrs. Bursey's sister, I believe. And he was living a couple of years ago still. When he left the Sedonis, he worked on the Phoenix Project.
Yes, he did wonderful things.
Well, he was brilliant.
What's the Phoenix Project?
Well, it was something to do with atoms and things.
Don't ask me. Yes, it was very complicated.
Mm. Uh-huh.
But he had been part of what Sedoni had, the Valley Research?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The lab
Meredith
down the water?
Was still there. Mm-hmm. His father had been the head of the Northwestern, or Great Northwestern Railways, and Meredith had an excellent education.
Yes.
Very, very good. And the first time he met Uncle Joe was, they were sitting on a bench in a park before he went to work for him. And Uncle Joe had a riding crop or something in his hand. And he said, "Look, Meredith," and he made a couple of symbols. I think a circle and a triangle or something. And, he told him to look away. And he did. No, he had Meredith do it. That was it. He said, "Make something there. Just draw a couple of things and then I'll tell you what it is." And he closed his eyes and he said, "You do a circle and a triangle." And Meredith said, "Well, how did you know?" And he said, "You tell me. Did I put it in your mind to do that? Or did you do it and I read your mind? Because I don't know." That was, you know. Mm.
How did, how would the Sedonis have gotten in contact with Frank Adams? Through the theater or just through a yacht club or through?
I don't know. They just always seemed to
have small town.
I think it
they
happened
would
when the movie stars came out and went up to the Valley of the Pines.
Pardon, what was that again?
When the movie stars came in.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yes,
that was later.
There were so many of them that came to see Joseph Senior.
That's right.
That was in the 20s and the 30s.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes, that was after
mm-hmm.
what we're talking about.
When the Sedonis first came, they camped, you know.
Yes.
Uh-huh. And then he had in his mind made up a place where he wanted to live, and when he saw the valley, he knew that was it. And it was just a little farmhouse then. Nothing nice, no electric lights or anything. They built all of that later. And Uncle Joe used to come in the winter time in the sleigh, and he'd have the boys and Aunt Lily, and my grandfather had Conley's Pharmacy, which is where the local pub is now. And so he had a stove in the back of the drugstore, and he used to drop them off. That's how my family came to know them so well. He'd drop them off so they could sit in by the stove until he did the shopping and they were ready to go back to the valley.
Mm-hmm. Well, Grace, it was a small community.
Yeah. Sure, and that's how they, you
and
know, everybody
are not traveling like they used
no.
to, so they are getting together oftener either in the little drugstore
mm-hmm.
or the tobacconist yeah. shop downtown.
And then they were great on
everybody
the lake, you know.
Everybody.
The Sedonis sailed and did all those things too. And they just knew a lot of people, and that's how they apparently got to be friends.
How about Frank Adams and the Wabanango Jinx? Like, how did he do those?
No, there was a jinx 2 years before they came in 1908. It was just just little acts. And then when he and his wife arrived, they decided to make it more of a production. And from then on, I think it was not called the Wabanango Jinx at that time. Before that, then, he named it the Wabanango Jinx, and he put on a show every year from 1908 to 1917, I guess, when he went overseas.
But did she continue it, I wonder? She did this at the theater, but I don't know about it.
Yes, she worked with him, yes.
Mm-hmm. And then when he went overseas, she took over for the theater.
She did some
theater,
of them,
but right. I don't know whether she did the Jinx or not.
I don't think she did.
I don't think they had the Jinx during
the
war.
No, I don't think she did. She may have worked in Whitehall, but she didn't at the beach.
No, I didn't think so.
And then he resumed in 1922, and he put on 22, 23, 24, 25, and I think up to 28. And then he turned it over to some of his youngsters who had been interested in the show, like Jeannie Schmidt's son. Mm-hmm. And they took it on from then. From then on, it's been run by the Lamateurs, who worked under Frank one time. Mm-hmm.
It's a remarkable story about the Jinx.
Yes,
really.
It is.
Mm-hmm. Well, is there some continuity, like if he did the Jinx between 1908 and 1917, and then, but the Wabanango Jinx was only basically, was that a full-time summer thing, or was it still just one or two nights?
Two nights.
When he was doing 1908 and 1917.
Mm-hmm. So they rehearsed all summer long.
Okay.
It was a finished product.
Because what I was kind of getting at was that, like, if 1908 to 1917 he did the Wabanango Jinx, the theater over here was built in 1916, and that, you know, it's like going from a more temporary, non-extended production thing to, obviously, a community theater. That's quite a step.
Our Grace, come in. Come into the story. How many years did you put a production on over there?
Oh, I did it, and that was in the 50s, I think, in the 50s. And I don't remember, I did The Man Who Came to Dinner, Strange Bedfellows, Night Must Fall. I can't remember.
Was that, Grace, was that then this group, which was called the White Lake?
No, this, but we
the White Lake
a
Players?
New group. When I moved from Montague over to Whitehall, back to, well, I'd been born in Whitehall. I called up Florence Esterling and Mary Koval, she was it then, and I asked them if they knew of people that would be interested in the theater, you know, and we formed the White Lake Players. In fact, you know, when we finally disbanded, there was money in the bank.
Well,
and they called up and said, you know, what do you want to do instead of the White Lake Players? And I said, well, I don't know, so I called some of them, and I forget what we did. We gave it to something, some local thing, you know. I didn't know we had money in the bank.
I see, because this mentions, like, then came the summer of 1960s, we're talking about the White Lake Players, all right?
What is this?
This program, because
Charles Seeger did a number of shows, too.
Because this says, then came the summer of 1962, enthusiasm.
Oh, that's Bob Adams.
Because then that's Bob Adams, that's like Lynn's brother, right.
Yeah. He brought up. Okay.
That's the group out of Flint.
Mm-hmm. Right,
they had the Flint summer tent. And they would bring in, they had a regular stock company, but they would bring in one star each week. I know because the one week, Ruth Zatsky called me up, Ruth Sharp, and she said, Grace, the woman that was coming from New York, it was about 3 days before the show, she's the woman that was coming from New York, is sick and can't come. Would you do the part that she was going to do? The show was It's Never Too Late. And Maureen O'Sullivan did the role on the stage, and I think she was the one that was going to come in. So I did it opposite Bob Adams.
Well, Grace just said, no problem.
Right. We can work on that. Well, what else? Do we want to...
Well, Frank did help me a couple of times on the minstrels, when the band parents were giving the minstrels, and he would write me letters. He used to come to see the shows, you know, and he wrote me letters after each production. And so then I called him up and I said, would you help me out on the minstrel? Would you do one act that would be produced by you? And he did. But I can't remember the one year
The one year I remember, it was Russ Kleinfelder, George Weston, Jim Young, and some others. And they did, they were dressed in costumes as chorus girls and made up as chorus girls. And poor Russ Kleinfelder, he could never get the one where they lift their knee and slapped it. He'd shove his knee down. It was really funny. It was very good. And one night, Jane Moog was late coming, and Frank was there to rehearse his act. So he said, "You play the piano?" Well, I said, "Well, a little." He said, "Well, you sit down and play." Well, I was reluctant to play because Frank was a perfectionist, you know. And so just as I started, she came in, and I was never so happy to see anybody as I was that. And that was fun, having him do that, those things again.
I can remember him coming and watching those acts.
Yeah.
Yeah, we have Frank Adams being born in 1883. When did he die?
In 1963. He was 80 when he died.
Hmm. Yeah. Okay. 63.
He was born in 83 and he died. Yeah, isn't that 80? Mm-hmm. 63?
And then Mrs. Adams, Lorna Adams, is now in San Diego with Penny. Okay.
Who did she marry again when Frank died? I can't think. He played the piano.
Earl Lanouette.
He died too, didn't he?
Yes.
Yeah. I've been trying to rack my brain to think what the name was, and I couldn't think of it.
I talked to her on Saturday.
He played
the drums, didn't he?
I thought he played the piano.
The drums, really?
Oh, the drums. That was the drums. I knew he played something, but I just got that out of here. And I thought, well, you don't have such a background in theater after all, do you? Because he didn't know what that was. Of course, it's so rare. I don't know whether they have others in this country now or not.
But I think something should be said about the New for Home that still stands. And the... I'm not sure if the present owners have left the dining room with the bunches of grapes. Can you remember?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
This was an antique shop for a while.
Yeah, well, what has happened to that? Is someone living there?
Yes, and they've been doing it over.
That's what I understand. They've just absolutely...
They aren't restoring it, huh?
Only from what I heard.
But... we had a meeting there, I don't know what organization was, and we went from room to room, and they were all in the process of being torn up, or being reconstructed. But the dining room, they had said they were going to keep because of the painting on the wall. These walls were purple with big Concord grapes, big bunches like this. It was most attractive. You won't believe it, but it was. Quite a conversation piece.
Yeah.
When Frank Adams gave a production of local people, were these like a week? Or they would go maybe every Saturday night for a month? Did a lot of people in the community fill the Playhouse? Or how did all that work?
It wasn't a continuing thing ever, was it? Just a special event once.
Just like the Jinx is now.
Yes, the Jinx was once a summer.
They'd rehearse for a few weeks. I don't know how often.
Did you do more than one show?
Well, I did the show.
In the same year.
Well, I didn't do anything until in the late 50s, the early 50s and 60s. And we just did, we'd do about three or four shows a season when we did it.
Oh, did you?
Mm-hmm.
Well, any of the minstrel shows, those 310 minstrel shows, that's a matter of give up about 2 weeks time.
So do it once every Friday night, every Friday, Saturday night, that sort of thing for two weeks?
Well, it's always on a schedule at a certain time, and I worked with three of the minstrel shows before we did the Black Parade.
Are the minstrel shows that sort of like the showboat stuff, is that all a spin off of the legacy of Frank Adams?
No. Because those were listed, you see, but they were done by the Masonic Temple, by the 310. And these men who were very active, and this is what they...
And then when they didn't do it any longer, the high school picked it up, the band parents.
What happened, we had a community chorus. Mm-hmm. And from that community chorus, it evolved into the minstrel shows then.
Charles Cedar.
Because we were doing those minstrel shows for 17 years, or something like that.
Charles Cedar never worked in the shows with Frank, did he?
No. Charles always had, he also had that group of women who had such beautiful voices.
Masonic Temple, the women.
That's right. And there was possibly eight or ten.
They had beautiful voices.
And they did these special concerts. So you mm-hmm. see, we've got all these things that went on at that mm-hmm. time. So everybody was kept busy with one thing or another.
That's right.
I think it's interesting because basically what you're saying is that people got together, you know, like they met the Sedonis or they met different people for different reasons and they got together and then they decided to give a show, and that rather than sort of like going down to the video store and plugging something in and watching somebody else do something, they did it. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that's the participation, that's the coming together, that's the glue, that's the community aspect that came out of all that.
Well,
just the associations.
This is the thing I think we older people realize, that lifestyle has changed so. You do not have groups getting together like they used to, whether it's the Masonic
yep.
Lodge or whether it's the Eastern Star or whether it's the Woodman or what. Mm-hmm. We've changed everything. And this, I think, is an interesting point to remember on this thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, community. Okay, shall we call it quits? It's now about 5:00, and anybody else want to say anything?
Got any special thing that anybody wants to know? Why? Certainly, I'm sure Peg Van would be happy, or Grace, or any. But I'm thinking in terms of you.
Well, yeah. Who else would you think might be helpful if Gene wanted to contact somebody to talk more about Frank Adams or the New Frank Adams?
Well, Art Sedoni would. Of course, I know B had a stroke, but I talked.
Is this recent?
Well, about a year ago, I guess.
Yeah.
She's in Brookhaven.
She did. Not Art.
No. I talked to Art the other day, and he said I'm still playing golf. So I think he's somebody that would be good to contact because he's the only one left mm-hmm. of the Sedoni family that was active.
And,
yes,
and maybe
right.
he could fill in that gap between, you say it ran until 1916, that he was putting productions on until, is that the date you had?
Actually,
there?
1908, 1917, then 1922 to 1928.
Into 28.
That was the Wabanango Jinx, though.
Yeah, well, the Wabanango Jinx, now that, I don't know what happened, I'd be curious to know what happened to both those theaters from 28 on, whether they, you thought that he turned it over to, people you named would have not have been old enough to take over. Doug Schmidt wouldn't have been old enough.
Well,
in
he probably wouldn't, but there we had a children's
early
entertainer,
40s.
I think Marshall or something like that her name was, lived in the clubhouse, and she put on a show during that time. Mm-hmm.
Well, we put on three one summer at the Wob Club, the Civic Theater. I had a group that we traveled around, and we went up to Ludington and Manistee. In fact, we reopened the Randall Theater. That was the first time that they had that theater reopened in 20-some years.
Boy, and that has been,
And we opened that. And then I had a group, I'll tell you who was in it. Harry Bratsberg, who was Colonel Potter in MASH, Harry Morgan, that was, you know, Colonel Potter
yes,
in the show
yes,
MASH,
yes.
and has been in so many, many things. And Harry was in that. And I get a kick out of it, but I directed him. And look where he is now.
And I can remember we did two or three things that summer. And I can remember one particularly because Harry came off the stage and I was playing an old woman. And this little girl, she's a middle-aged woman now, she was supposed to hit everybody on the foot with a hammer. And he came off and he said, "Ye God, she's really doing it." And he got a hold of his foot. And I gave her private dramatic lessons. And so when I went out on the stage and she came up to me and I grabbed her arm and I didn't let her go through with what she was supposed to do. I said, "That'll be enough of that, you know," I said to her. "There'll be no more hitting on people's feet." And it was not in the show, and she looked at me so startled, and I guess her father and mother in the front row did too, but she didn't do it. So that was Harry. They had quite a famous star there, but we didn't know it.
I was just kind of wondering, like in 1928, what Shirley was saying, 1928, he turned, you know, it kind of stops, and then he turns it over to somebody else. Yes. Like his 1928, I mean, he goes to California.
I think, yes, and I think he had heart trouble about that time. He had heart condition in California, and he was very careful from then on. And that's what he died of, was a heart attack.
Peg, how long did they live there in California? I can't remember.
Or what periods from would they have been in California?
Well, when Trix was living, they moved to California. They went to California, so it was during that time too that they were there.
Like, what's the date line on that? Is that after the war, after World War One, or before?
When did she die?
Well, they ended up living in California, where Lorna is now, and when Frank was still living, they bought a little house California. Mm-hmm. So I think they've always had some connection with California.
But didn't they continue to come back in the summer?
Oh, yes. Yes, they've always. Yes.
Pauline. Oh, yeah. They traveled back on 66.
Oh. Well, this girl that I used to have in the show, she played in Leeds and so forth for me several times, Civic Theater. And she went with them when Penny was about 2 years old. She was the nanny.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Pauline, and she married George Shipman.
Yes.
Uh-huh,
yes.
Pauline. Mm-hmm. And she lived with them out there.
And then this would have been like from the 1920s on? Or?
No, this would have been in the 40s. I'm trying to think when that
was. So they're still going to California then?
When did Trixie die and when did Lorna marry Frank Adams?
When Trix died?
Trix, I guess.
Let's see. I was married in 25, and Lorna was married about 3 years later, so it must have been Trix must have died in between that time. Mm-hmm. So, because Trix was at my wedding,
wasn't
I remember
in the 30s
and Frank were married probably in
28. That he married Lorna?
Was it that late?
I think so, because they were divorced, and then he and Lorna kind of went together, and Aunt Lily said to me, "He will never marry Lorna as long as Hades alive." And that was in, well, Pauline graduated when 32.
I had never heard that
me.
Story.
Uh-huh.
That they were divorced? His first wife and Frank were divorced?
Uh-huh.
Did you?
Yes, I knew that.
It's funny, that didn't come into the conversation.
Frank gave her the big house where I live. It's what he called it, the big house always. He, in the divorce proceedings, he gave the house to Trix. And she gave the house when she died to her mother, Mrs. Judd, who lived in California. Frank and Mrs. Judd, the senior, were very friendly. He took care of her in her old age very, very nicely. Had somebody as a nurse to take care of her, and they were friends.
Colonel Judd did live here for a while, too.
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes, that's right.
When they first came.
But she understood that Trix was a difficult person to live with. And,
well, you know, when they came here, the first time they came, she was not well. She was on a stretcher. They took her from the train. Colonel Judd was
Mrs. Judd or Trix?
Trix.
Oh, Trix, really?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, she had a very serious drinking problem, for one thing.
Yes, and drugs. That's why they came here.
Yeah,
he wanted to get her out of the life in the theater. And,
yes.
And they came here for that reason. Hmm. But that was, they must have been married somewhere between, oh, like 32 and sometime after that.
You mean Lorna Frank?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Well, because Penny was about 2 years old when Pauline Shipman
took
out there.
Mm-hmm.
That, what year would that have been when Pauline went out?
I don't know. It would have had to been in the late 30s, I would think. I would think before the war.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Penny and I are about the same age, and I think I was born in 1934, so I think she's probably born around 1934.
About 36 then probably would be. Yeah, I would think about 36 is when Penny was 2 years old.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I had Penny and the man who came to dinner when we did it here.
She's a nice lady.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what else? I guess that's it, huh?
Hmm?
I feel like Peggy could add more, just kind of personally, because you knew both of them personally.
Well, I wouldn't know where to start, because
right.
I have so many different memories over so many years
mm-hmm.
with them. It's
mm-hmm.
hard to keep continuity
mm-hmm.
for me.
One of you made the comment that someone said he would never marry Lorna while Trix was still alive.
Mm-hmm.
How long did Trix live after they were divorced?
I don't remember.
I don't think very long.
I think she was she was in poor health.
Yes, yes, she was. I don't think she lived very long.
But
and
I remember
then you've
her
had
telling
that cottage
me.
Since
then Lorna went to live with her family.
Mm-hmm.
After Trix died, of course.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and of course that is an interesting story too. I mean, it doesn't have to be repeated either, you know.
No.
Lorna finally married.
Yes.
Right, so that.
And you say it was in the 30s, yeah. Because
it was probably in the early 30s then that they were married, but it couldn't have been till after. It had to be in the 30s, because I'm going by when Penny was born.
Yes.
And that Pauline, the Tory, went out there with them, and I know Pauline had to be through high school by then, and that was 32 that she, or maybe she graduated in 31. No, I think she graduated in my class, 32.
So then, like, the Judds, like, were they from California? Was that?
No, I think they were from Chicago.
Chicago, okay.
He was a colonel in the Civil War,
hmm.
Colonel Judd.
Colonel Judd.
Mm-hmm. And they had, I think, just one child, Hazel.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. They named the cottage that I own Hazelcrest.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And in fact, we all had cottage names in those days. They since have gone. I don't think anybody has a name again. You still have yours to come to.
Mm-hmm. Phil Arthur Holtz finally sold his, didn't he?
Yes.
Pardon?
Phil Arthur Holtz sold his cottage.
Oh, yes, yes.
To the great glee of everybody that lives down there.
I'm very thankful, too. We are.
H. Close kept calling me up and saying, can't you say something to Phil about selling the cottage? And I said, well, why don't you call Phil? And but I knew the minute that he was no longer going to run that
yes,
he'd get out. He just kept that for an address.
He was never there anyway.
No. Mm-hmm. He just kept it for an address. And let it run down, I guess. The Closes were very upset about it, I know. Well, who is it that lives next door? Don't you live near them?
Barbie, my daughter.
Barbie.
Right,
oh, that's
door.
It. Yeah,
Barbie
I knew
Wagner.
There was, mm-hmm.
Like you mentioned it was called Hazelcrest, and you mentioned that Frank Adams always had a name for something. What did Frank Adams call the house when he had it?
That was it.
That was it after Hazel.
He named it for his wife, Hazel
gotcha.
Judd.
Okay.
Hazelcrest.
Okay.
But many of those cottages have revived their old names.
Yes, it would be fun to have them again, I think.
I think it is, too.
Oh, I think that would be nice to have the name back.
Epworth does that. It's heights.
Because we don't have, well, yes, we do have numbers, but we never think about that among ourselves, certainly.
But I remember when the Casparis built Barbie's Cottage.
Yes.
And they called her La Maisonette.
Yes.
She was French. Mrs. Casparry was French.
Was she French or Swiss?
Swiss, I guess.
Swiss, I think.
What happened to the clay cottage? Did that burn?
Is that the original?
Clay's.
No.
It was up on a hill.
Oh, that was the Hoods before that.
Before that,
uh-huh. Yes, it did.
I was there a couple of times with Mary Terry Berry. She is now Mary Montgomery. And she had been in Charles's show, Charles Peters. Uh-huh. And, but I heard that the clay cottage burned. Was that the one?
Well, that must have been the one you're thinking of, yes, because the present clay cottage was then built down on the shore,
that is
all right.
No.
Mm-hmm. Let's go through a transition. Like, okay, Frank Adams built the big house, Hazelcrest.
He didn't build it, he bought it.
Okay, he bought it in 1908.
It was 2 years old,
yes.
Wasn't it?
Okay.
Yes.
Then he leaves that house when you purchase it.
No.
We rented it for a couple of years, and then he wanted to sell it, and we didn't have that amount of money, so we rented them for several years.
All right.
Frank then rented to other people. And then he came to us in 1941, I think it was, and he said, I'd like you to have the cottage.
So he still had it in 1941?
He still had it, yes. So we bought it then.
Well, then when did he build the house down in
when
the
he and Lorna were married.
And that's where
they didn't want, she did not want to live in the big house.
Okay.
So they built a cottage down on the, we call it the desert.
Yeah, the sand, right. Yeah. Then that would have been in 19, they would have built that in the 1930s?
30s, I would think, yes.
And
I
that would have been their
exactly,
place,
but
their base when they were going back between California and here?
That's right.
And they didn't have to worry about the big house because the big house was rented out to other people.
Yes. Well, then we had it in 41, you see.
Right. Huh. Okay. If Penny was...
But you said that house went to his wife Hazel in the divorce
yes,
settlement.
Yes, and when
and
she died,
gave it to her mother.
Her mother. That is the ownership. Mrs. Judd never lived in it because she lived
during
in California.
During that time, who was living in it?
They were renting it to different people.
And
we rented it for
yet.
About 3 years, and then other people rented it.
I see. So, and you
it
hadn't come
about
yet.
5 years, I think, mm-hmm. from the time we rented until we bought it.
Mm-hmm.
But then that's really kind of owned by the Judds rather than the Adams. So, like, how could Mr. Adams have it until 1941? Because it was like her
it
side
was
of the
actually
family.
His mother-in-law's
yeah.
house.
Yeah.
But he took care of it because she... She didn't come to the beach when she was older. She stayed.
He was managing it for her.
She
okay.
stayed in California.
Okay.
And she had a young boyfriend who lived with her, a doctor. It was funny. She was 70-odd years old, I think, and the young man was like a son to her. Anyway, they lived together. It was one of the early living together sort of things that I heard about.
Hmm. And then she lived in Los Angeles, or where?
Let's see, where would it be? Yes, it would have been Los Angeles, I think.
Hmm.
And Penny, did Penny and Frank, Lorna and Frank, did they live in San Diego? Where
they do, they did, yes, then they moved to San Diego.
Not where Lorna lives now. They lived in a different location originally.
The Adams,
right.
Well,
a different house, yes.
Yeah.
A different house.
I'm just thinking of the addresses that I've written.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, but it's still San Diego.
San Diego. Okay. Yeah. Also, Leonard and I were out there at one time. And
yes.
When they lived.
Visiting Frank Adams.
Yeah, Frank.
And that was in San Diego.
Yeah.
It
that's
was so.
When
you say like he went to Hollywood, Hollywood is not San Diego.
No, but that was long before. 20 years before we're talking about now.
Okay.
Yeah.
When Penny was little, they lived next door to both Filofsky, I think his name was. He was a director.
Yes, I remember that name.
And he became interested in Pauline because she was very good on the stage and everything. And he was going to give her a screen test, and he had a heart attack and died.
Scared him to death.
Timing and everything, isn't it?
Right.
I just happened to remember that. So that must have been when they were in Hollywood.
Yes. They had a wonderful time at Hearst's Ranch.
San Simeon, right?
San Simeon, oh yeah.
Yes, it was wonderful. And I guess everybody knows that he kept it under construction all the time.
Oh, it was right. Never finished.
Right.
He would die, he said, if he stopped.
Interesting.
But they had lots of stories to tell about him.
And then the children, the boys, turned against Marion Davies.
Marion Davies. Yeah.
And then they found out she had the controlling stock.
And she didn't come to the funeral.
Oh, they wouldn't let her, no.
Yeah.
She was a very nice person, Lorna said. Very nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, she really saved the she saved the Hearst Corporation at one time.
Yes, she had done that before. She'd given him, I don't know, a million or more.
Yeah.
And then when he died, of course, they whisked him out of the house. She'd laid down. She'd been sitting up nights, and they whisked him out of the house. And she didn't know he was dead. When she woke up, they told her that he was dead. And that she had no longer any interest in calling the paper or doing anything with the paper. And she said, there I was. And what did she call him? Old, what was his initials?
William Randolph, W.R.
W.R. She said, all these years, and he was gone. And I didn't even get a chance to say goodbye. So she kept still about everything. And they were horrible to her, and they wanted her to get out of the house and everything. So when they came to read the will, they found he'd given her the controlling stock. But she was very generous. She didn't hold them up. I don't know whether she sold it back to them or what she did, but mm-hmm. she got rid of it somehow.
Yes, San Simeon is now one of the big tourist attractions in California.
Yeah.
It's an incredible place.
I wonder what's happened to that place now.
It's a landmark, and it's a state park.
Oh, is it really?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
There was quite a story about just a short time ago on one of the.
Oh yeah.
The state has like the building and some of the grounds, but then Hearst actually own hundreds of thousands of acres.
Oh, I guess that's right. Yes.
And miles of.
Well, his
of
mother
Pacific
had
frontage.
Owned them, hadn't she?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. The old senator, William Randolph's father, has a long mining.
Mm-hmm.
For feminists like Phoebe Apperson Hearst,
was it his daughter or his granddaughter that got into trouble, the Hearst girl?
Patty.
She was a granddaughter.
Yeah. Granddaughter, yes.
Mm-hmm. I guess her father's dead now.
And she, the poor baby, lives up in Greenwich, Connecticut. Happily ever after.
She married her bodyguard.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, should we call it quits?
All right. Mm-hmm.
Great, thank you.
Are you satisfied? Project?
I think we got some stuff. What do you think?
A little disconnected, but
yeah, actually,
you didn't expect it to be connected.
Yeah, I just wanted to get
it
something.
Doesn't matter. It was just time that we got together and recognized and remembered somebody who's been very important in our community.
Yeah.
Whether it's because of the theater or otherwise.
Mm-hmm.
Lorna could have added a lot, couldn't she?
Yes, she could. Well, as I said to Roger when he talked to me the other day, I said, well, Roger, we're 1 year late.
Yeah. But for a while, Lorna hadn't been willing to go.
No, she was not interested in getting involved. And I think that's the word right there. Right there.
Well, I think she wasn't physically comfortable. I mean, she heard a lot. Moving around, so she just stayed home.
These were some of the magazines that Peg Vander Ven brought along with her in Muncie. The article's called Mr. Man by Frank R. Adams, author of Five Fridays, Jingle Bells, etc., a complete novel. And it says copyright 1915, Frank Adams. And then we have Miles Brewster and the Super Sex in Cosmopolitan magazine, July 1921. And this says, you can always depend upon the excellence of a story by Frank R. Adams, just as you can depend on the excellence of Cosmopolitan. He has permanently established himself as one of the big stars among short story writers. That was in Cosmopolitan. The next one is A Woman Around the House, a gay little story about one solitaire too many. And this was in the new Smart Set, and that is April 1930. It's kind of got a great sort of, this is illustrated. Okay, what else we got? This was Cosmopolitan. Did we get a date on this? We don't. It's going to be in the front somewhere, isn't it? Actually, that's just... Okay, then in Cosmopolitan, October 1921, there's a story called Mrs. You by Frank R. Adams, illustrated by Charles D. Mitchell, etc. And then in Liberty, this is Liberty, April 30th, 1927. It's called The Painted Alibi, a story of a murder that tested the love of two women by Frank R. Adams. Okay. And then this one is called Liberty Magazine, April 2, 1927. It's called Oysters in Season, Romance Prize, A Professor Out of His Shell, a short story by Frank Adams. That's it. And then there's the book, When I Come Back, Frank R. Adams, I mentioned earlier in the tape.
I read some of those stories and they're
Robert McBride.
They're so
That's
naive,
it.
Really.
So, wait, Harriet, okay, now just say what you said about his collection. Okay, Frank Adams' collection went to?
The University of Oregon. They wanted it and they came and Lorna took out of the stacks of their library the special books that she wanted and kept. The rest was taken in toto, right out there.
To the University of Oregon.
To the University of Oregon. And they did this in memory of Frank.
Why do you think it went there?
Well, this is done so often with many of these collections.
Mm-hmm.
And all
I mean, all the planting plans for Gertrude Jekyll, the landscape, the wonderful perennial landscape lady from England, end up in Berkeley,
there
University of California.
Yeah.
Why Oregon? Yeah, why Frank Adams and Oregon?
I don't know. I can't remember why, but there was a lot of talk
either.
About it
well,
because
a,
none
I
of us understood.
An article and
you think
in the
University
paper.
Of Chicago.
Right.
Where he went to.
This was like during the 50s, the 60s, or actually in the 60s after his death,
no.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah.
Sometimes the logical one doesn't
stand.
But she could answer that.
Yeah, okay.
Or Penny could.
Yeah, okay. Great. Okay.
I wonder.
And was there a
Jameson's? Notes that were stuck in between the leaves. Well, you know. Maybe they were looking for $1 million. I don't know.
Did you happen to talk to Penny when she was here?
My grandfather out. That had been
the other evening. Bill Lonowet was saying.
And then my father's in 1917. And then my father sold it to Bud Johnson.
The task of going through all the books was enormous.
Was there a saloon?
So she was thinking, well, maybe I could.
It says Fox's.
No, but
saloon.
Make a quick job.
Oh, yeah.
But
and then
the first book that she took opened out to, and I can't remember what.
And I wondered if that were Johnson's.
Well known author. It was a letter from him.
It says sample room, meaning that you could go in it. Well, Bud was quite a heavy drinker himself.
Oh, really?
Frank Adams was a personal
so
friend. I should remember who it was, but
that's
I don't
I'm glad
remember.
That you recognize that as.
That was so startling that she decided that she was going to have to go through each one carefully because there could be things of note stuck in those books.
Yeah, I wish I could
that
see
made,
their
that
faces.
Made the task much harder.
It took them forever.
And Lorna really wanted the books. That was the one thing that she wanted out of the house.
Yeah.
I mean, there were other things too, but that the books were important to her.
Yeah, I felt that the whole...
was also a big coach house. So you see,
don't
you wonder
think,
how they happened to
don't
choose.
Don't you think Jim Newfer owned the
theater family? Location we're talking
well,
about.
Must have.
Because he was right down the street. I bet you Jim.
Yeah,
that, it
that's
seems
right,
to me,
he would have lived within
and,
three blocks.
And he gave the property. See,
oh,
yeah,
that must be, because I got to thinking about that, the fact that there was that old boarding house there, which
is on your parking lot, right? That would be on your parking lot lot.
On that 90 feet.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, we bought the 90 feet of property from somebody who came from Michelinda. Right offhand, I can't. Somebody who was involved with Michelinda Beach Lodge.
Does anybody know who actually built the theater building?
I don't think
so. I wonder who their architects were.
We could look in the old forms.
Oh, the papers, sure. Right, yeah.
I bet you.
1916 is missing in the observers, but I'm sure the forms.
Because they'd boast about that.
Oh, exactly.
Yeah.
That's what I said. Sure, that's right. Tiemann built this house. This I know, Tiemann from Montague.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, it was built in 1902. So, but you see, this was...
There's a subscription of the Old House Journal, Edna, which actually I give to the library over in Montague to keep people interested in old houses. And there's a whole article about concrete block buildings like yours, like this one. And it's like the July issue or something like that.
Oh.
Should check it out and let you read it, kind of thing. It's kind of interesting. Yeah.
I came across I'm out finding things since I moved, and boxes and things. I was looking for some of the things about the theater and everything, and I found the obituary of my grandfather Connolly, who died in 1920, and I'd forgotten he built the Pitkin block.
Oh.
That still, it must have been built pretty well because it's still standing.
Yeah.
And it said several other homes in Whitehall,
mm-hmm.
and I don't know what they were. I know that he built the little cottage where it's just been sold recently to people who are going to use it as summer home. I think it's across from City Hall, where Jack Sharp lived.
Oh, yeah.
He built that, and that my mother was 106 and a half when she died, and that was 4 or 5 years ago, and she was born in that house, and he built it when they were married, and he built the... house that I was born in, which is a mess today, and the Harwood House was built in 1883.
What's the Harwood House?
That's the red brick house that the people that had the restaurant were trying to buy.
Okay, sure.
And then
across the fire station.
Whoever bought it called me up one day and said you suggested they get in touch with
right,
me.
Right, right.
So I
right.
said if you look up at the ceiling, you'll see that it says 1883, and that's when the house was built.
Huh.
They're working.
So that's one of the older ones.
Yeah.
Sorry, he must have been enormous.
Part one. Scene one is infinite space. Okay. And then there's some musical. Okay. And then scene two is the Michigan woods with Indian princes, Chief Wabanengo, Chief Minchalinda, Per Marquette, and Sal Morin. I mean, you explain that one, all right?
Yes, I remember him.
Actually, it says Sal Morin, Mr. Meinhardy, Indians. I guess they probably acted as Indians. Okay. Scene three is Lake Street in Whitehall. Little Willie, otherwise known as Bill, boys from school. Then scene four is the Old Coble Sawmill. With the foreman of the mill, the Indian girls, and the lumberjacks, okay? Part two, scene four. I guess I'm doing this in sequence, I guess. I don't know. Scene five, the woods, with the shepherd and the shepherdess, Mr. Crandall and Miss Grantham. Scene six, Lake Street, Whitehall, 1861.
Who did? Oh,
yeah.
And then we have scene seven, parlor of Colonel Washburn's home in Virginia during the Civil War. Like, you kind of wonder, how did we get the Civil War in this script?
Anyway,
it has Rosalind Washburn, Lieutenant Fairfax, Sylvia Washburn, Private Hassenpfeffer, Cerise Snow, a Negro mammy, Colonel
that
Al...
That was Jim Newfer.
Yeah, it says Mr. Therese, Newfer, you're right.
That's where they had...
A nigger mammy, right.
That's where the stairs that the Sidonis built, the collapsible stairs.
Oh, yes, yeah.
When I was 2 years old, you know, and they took me to see the show because my father and mother were... And the stairs collapsed, and I screamed and yelled so loud that they had to take me home, so they missed the opening.
Then there's a scene, part three, scene eight, is Lake Michigan in winter. The flame of ice, spirit... The Flame of Ice Spirits of the Icebergs, Miss Grantham, a ballet produced by Mr. Adams and Mr. Crandall.
Do you remember the Crandalls?
Yeah, oh, sure.
Elizabeth Crandall was my best friend.
Yeah.
And she had a pony, and it lived at the beach.
In your garage?
No, it had a shed of its own.
Oh, did it? I thought it lived in the garage.
No, and she, Elizabeth went out and exercised that horse every morning.
Yes.
Well, you get all these
things. Went down to the channel and went through clear to Duck Lake and back.
Yeah, along the shore of Michigan, too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, then we get into part three. Okay, scene 8, Lake Michigan in the winter. Okay, we would flame the ice, we did that. Okay. Mm-hmm. Then scene 9, Black Magic, the spooky girl, played by Gertrude Flitcraft. Scene 10, the telephone exchange at Whitehall.
Yeah, that's the picture, isn't it?
Uh-huh. Miss Whitehall, Hazel Adams, Mr. Montague, Mr. Dye.
That must have been Hazel Adams singing.
Oh, it could have been, okay.
Hazel, yeah. Yes.
That was she singing Hello Central.
Yes. Oh, okay.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Then Mr. Pitkin is played by Mr. Pitkin. Mr. Skeels, played by Dr. Cole. President Wilson, Mr. Meinhardy. The Young Lady in Hot Water by Miss Pitkin. Miss Patricia Casey, played by Miss Olds. Okay, then the next scene is, I mean, we've been to Virginia, et cetera. Now we're in
the Civil War.
Yeah, now we're in scene 11, and it's the White Lake Garage.
Oh, next door to the telephone company.
Harry Charlton, yeah. Dr. Bowl, Walter Johnson, a pretty baby, and other pretty babies.
That Frank Adams finally was.
That's a garage he ended up buying, right? Then scene 12 is on the beach, a summer resort man and bathing girls. And then it goes into a whole bunch of the different songs. There's So Long, Whitehall, America, I Love You, Heap Love, Puppet Dance, Everyone Loves Our Mary, So Long, Whitehall.
A lot of scenes.
Ice Ballet, My Spooky Girl, Hello, Whitehall, that's when you're talking about. This is Hazel
Adams,
right?
Yeah, Hello, Whitehall. And the song was really Hello Central. Give me heaven. That was it. But there were different words to this. Hello, Whitehall. And Frank had written different
14.
Words.
If I knock the L out of Kelly.
You'll knock the L out of me.
Oh, I remember that. That was an old 78. I remember Aunt Dolly Flaxton had that. You'd play it. If you knock the L out of Kelly, she'll knock the L out of you. Mm-hmm. Right. Okay. Then Pretty Baby. Everybody Loves a Baby. That's Why I Love You. Okay. The Magic Melody. And then the finale. Okay. And then the list of different people. Mm-hmm. So this is just a big blown up program of the little one that Penny
Cole,
gave.
Dr. Cole had one of the very first cars, and it was red.
Oh.
And they didn't have colors in those days. And he was married to Mrs. Moog, Jane.
Really?
You know, Ferris Moog. Ferris Moog's. He's an undertaker, you know. Mold.
Yes.
And he was married to her, and they had a son, Lamar. And then they were divorced. But one day before they were, he took her for a ride. And they got in a terrible fight. And he was going through Whitehall, and she was screaming, help, help, I'm being kidnapped, murder, and so forth. Well, they were divorced. And Dr. Cole went to Battle Creek or someplace, and started a clinic for alcoholics and drugs, and he became very, very wealthy. And Mrs. Moog, or Mrs. Cole, married Moog. And he used to come back every summer, and he'd have a limousine with a chauffeur, and he'd come up and call on everybody in Whitehall to let her see how well he was doing. And then she had Ferris with Moog. And Dr. Cole, she wanted to let Lamar work in the summer, and he didn't want him to. He wanted him to come and visit him, but he went to work down on the docks, and he drowned.
Also, you're bringing this up. Dr. Cole's daughter was Lorna's best friend.
Oh, really?
Her and daughter. That's how Lorna became acquainted with the Adamses,
with the Adams
and became so close to
what
the
was her name?
And Frank. Dorsey.
Dorsey.
Okay.
Yeah.
I've been thinking about about that.
I could see you were thinking, you know, I could see you they were thinking. You know. He was quite a colorful figure.
I didn't know him, but...
He used to always come to see us every summer. He'd come, you know.
And Dr. Cole?
Dr. Cole. He'd stop. We lived on Peck Street in Muskegon. And every summer, Dr. Cole would come, and we'd see this big chauffeur car pull up, and we knew it was Dr. Cole and his wife. And he'd say, well, I'm going up to Whitehall and give the old girl something to think about.
Well, then Dorothy stayed with her father. Huh? Dorothy stayed with her father then. Mm-hmm. I didn't realize that, because we were told that Mrs. Cole and her brother had died, and that Dr. Cole was a widower.
Well, it seemed to me, they must have had the daughter. Was it his daughter?
Well, I thought, I don't know. I just knew Dorothy, and I never met Dr. Cole, but I know he's a good friend.
Well, his wife did die. And I can't remember where it was, Battle Creek or where it was, that he, but he became very wealthy.
I think he was in the service with Frank.
Yeah, he'd been in the service.
They joined together.
Mm-hmm. Hmm. Yeah, I'd forgotten all about him till I saw the program.
Well, actually, what about war years? Like, okay, Frank Adams went to war, and he went as a private, as an officer?
No, he was commissioned right away.
Okay.
And I thought I had pictures. I have pictures of him in his uniform, and I evidently left them home.
And then he was sent to basically, okay, France?
He was in France the whole time.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Hmm. That's too far back for us, Fred Jean, the 1418. This was a recording that we did on Frank Adams, the Newford Adams Playhouse, over at Edna Bloomdahl's last Saturday, September 23rd, 1995. We met at Edna, sat around the dining room table, and there was Grace Atkinson, who is known for her Whitehall Theater productions and also Civic Theater productions. She sort of missed theater from County of Muskegon, coached Nancy Fleming for Miss America and things like that. Great knowledgeable stories about theater and also the Adams. Peggy Van Deventer was a personal friend of Frank Adams and also Lorna Adams. And she bought the old Adams cottage up on the hill called Hazelhurst, which we found out was named after Mr. Adams' first wife. Edna Bloomdahl also had Sylvan Beach connections and council person from Whitehall, owns the land around the Newford Adams Playhouse, long knowledge about Whitehall area. Shirley Milne was there. She helped drive Harriet and Peggy from Sylvan Beach on up, and then Harriet Pearson Berman from Sylvan Beach, longtime member of the group down there and also knowledgeable about Wabanengo Jenks and things like that. Also Gene Michelson, Historical Society, and Roger Scharmer, Historical Society. We had a good session. We sat around. It was a nice afternoon, and there's lots more to say, and obviously we didn't have the time, but we got this, and we think it's pretty good. Thank you. Bye-bye.